Download and stay connected with the Changing Your World podcast with Creflo Dollar. Keep the Word of God at the forefront of your mind with these powerful and uplifting messages.
Think how much more the blood of Christ cleans up our whole lives inside and out.
With each message that you download and stream, you gain revelation of the fullness of God's grace.
I'm talking about the grace of God that comes over your life, that makes living easy, that makes living sweatless, that the anointing begins to come up on you and there's not a fight, there's not a struggle.
The Changing Your World podcast brings you life-changing wisdom right at your fingertips, no matter where you are. Subscribe today on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your preferred podcast platform. Creflo Dollar Ministries TV app brings you live church services direct to your smart TV and much more. Don't miss a service and catch up on the latest messages from Creflo and Taffy Dollar, like No More Worries, Overcoming Uncertainty, and countless other life-changing series streaming on the Creflo Dollar Ministries TV app. You'll also get access to Changing Your World Network, streaming grace messages and exclusive content 24 hours a day right in the app.
The commandment is to honor our parents and to see them as valuable.
We want to change our life. We have to start within. We have to start by how we're thinking in our innermost thoughts.
Get unlimited streaming through Roku, Amazon, and Apple TV absolutely free. Visit your app store, search Creflo Dollar Ministries, and download the Creflo Dollar Ministries TV app now to start streaming. For more information, visit CreflodollarMinistries.org.
God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three yet one, truth and grace, power and sacrifice, love and peace. He is the creator of the universe, but I know him personally. Have you met him? He's vastly personal, a mysterious yet clear presence, bridge, a connection, the Holy Spirit, God Himself. Through Him, our insignificance is transformed by significant love. Have you seen Him? He is invisibly present. His work is evident, palpable. He reaches into our mortal world and embraces us, changes us. Have you heard Him? He speaks truth, an intimate tension between the spiritual and physical, connecting creation with Creator. Do you know Him? Simply profound, vastly personal, invisibly present.
Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before Him, He endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider Him who endured such opposition, so you will not grow weary and lose heart.
Hallelujah. Anybody ready to give God glory tonight? God, we give you thanks. God, we give you thanks for your constant faithfulness, for your constant grace. Your new mercies every morning. I tell you right where you want to give Him thanks. Give Him thanks for all He's done. No matter what you're feeling like, give Him thanks. We choose to give you glory, God. We choose you, Lord. We choose to have joy. We choose your peace, God. Jesus the same yesterday, today, and again. God, move like never before. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You ready? You ready? The lame man walk again. You call
Thank you. It was over. You made a Hey there, is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired word of God and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Good evening, World Changers. Welcome to Saturday Service. It's Pastor Wes. I'm excited to bring you another life-changing message. First, I want to welcome our beloved New York family. Thank you guys for your love, your prayers, support. Man, we pray for you daily and expect just blessing and goodness. To those tuning in around the world, partners, eChurch, we know we got people all the United States, some people in some different countries. Thank you guys for joining tonight. It's so awesome to have you here. If it's your first time, thanks for checking us out. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak in your life. I pray this message blesses you, and I pray that you have an authentic connection with God that changes your life only for the better. All right, let's get right in this. Let's do communion as we always do. Man, we want to put ourselves in remembrance and remind us. You can be going through so many things this week thinking God's mad at you, maybe God's against you, maybe there's something broken, maybe you're going through something, and we have to put our focus back on, man, God is so good that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. And that's what the cross reminds us and the resurrection of Jesus. And that is a declaration. So as we take the bread, we remind the body of Jesus was broken for us in every way possible. The most horrific death that we could ever probably record it ever. And still, you can't even fathom what all really happened. But that was for us. That was so we can experience wholeness in every way possible. We can receive wholeness in every way possible. So as you take this, remember, you're whole in your heart. You're whole in your mind. You're whole in your physical body. It's completeness when I say wholeness is what it is. So as you take this, you're complete in Christ Jesus, and you can eat. So as we take this juice, it reminds us of the blood of Jesus that was freely poured out on us, showing God is so merciful. The biggest thing about the cross was in that moment, at humanity's worst, they literally murdered God. They killed God, Jesus and God in flesh. And what was the response from Jesus? After all that, the beating, the brokenness, everything, God, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Showing this infinite overflowing love that should stand out to us that God for all eternity, if present, past, present, future, is infinitely pouring out mercy and goodness and not wrath, not judgment. This is who God truly is. So as you take this, know everything is forgiven. Everything is washed. You have no reason to be shame or guilty, and you are free to experience your relationship with God, and you can drink. All right, let's get right into this part two of the series. I've been talking about expect to thrive. We want to set our mindset. We want to be so excited. We want to be so encouraged. I want you so pumped, not just emotionally pumped, not just a feel-good pump, but a moment of knowing, man, I expect to thrive. And I have this mindset of not just surviving, not failure, not anything less than expecting to continuously thrive and grow in God. Because God is for me. We talked about that last week. I'm going to give you about a 5 to 10 minute quick recap, closer to five because we got a lot of stuff to get into from last week, and catch everybody kind of briefly up, and then we're going to jump right into this tonight. So I want to give the, once again, remind the definition of expect. Expect is regard something to likely happen. Now, that can be positive or negative. It's what we choose, and we'll get into what that really means tonight. We're going to hammer that down a little more. And what we choose daily, what we expose ourselves, what we allow to creep into our heart and our belief system and our thinking is what that is. So we want to choose to expect to thrive. So that leads us to reminding, what's the definition of thrive? So we know what we're exactly expecting. It means to grow or develop well or develop well, vigorously is what that is. It means to also prosper or flourish. So when we're expecting it is likely to happen, and with God it is assuredly to happen, by the way, we're expecting to thrive, to flourish, to prosper, to grow also. But where does that start? And that's where we cover our foundation scripture. So let's go ahead and read that is what we're going to do. And that was over in Matthew 5:8 is where that was. So Matthew 5:8 says, you're blessed when you get your inside world right. Your mind and your heart put right, that is. Then you can see God in the outside world. And last week we talked about, how do I see God? It's in the most little things. It's like I got up on time, I was able to get out the door and get the kids out the door real quick in school, and man, all of a sudden, the day is just running smooth. It's God's goodness right there. Today I got up, and man, my shoulder had been hurting for a week straight every morning I got up. I got up this morning, feels good, there's no pain. I can do what I used to not be able to do. That's a moment of God's goodness is what it is. Oh, the light bill, man, it got paid on time this month. Last month, it was 30 days behind. I got it caught up kind of deal. Well, I happened to get it paid on, so now it's not stressing me. Sometimes I've had moments where I get a little stressed out about the finances, and then I forget. I did get this bill paid on time, though, but you got these other bills. But I did get this one bill paid on time. What am I setting my mind and my expectation? Man, there's a moment of God's goodness. So if God and I worked it out with the wisdom of God and the finances, got this one paid, the next one will get paid. And we'll get into a little more what that is. But you're setting your inside world, because I want people out of the mindset of, man, I'm looking for the world to change. If this nation would change, if these politics would get right, if this would end, if that would end, I'd be a lot happier. Wrong. It would help be a lot happier. Trust me. It would definitely help a lot of happiness. It would make a lot of life a lot better. You know, money can't buy happiness, but it sure can buy a good vacation. I don't know. There's a little bit in that, maybe. But in the point being, I've been in times and seasons in my life where everything was going good, but the inside felt horrible. And I was unable to enjoy the precious moments. So no matter what's in our control, the inside world is what is. And we're able to control that daily. And with God's power is what we're able to do by submitting to Him. We're able to thrive. So your thrive can always be happening on the inside, even when it doesn't look like it's happening on the outside. We talked about last week, we want to shift our perspective to change our response to things is what it is. Instead of responding in fear, we respond in faith is what we do. So we did Matthew 5. We went over to John 3, 3 John. Of course, there's only one chapter, by the way. But we're going to go over there and read it again. 3 John chapter 1, verse 2. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. And that's what we want to focus on. We're working on being the healthiest version of ourselves. Because when we're going to be healthier on the inside, and we're just going to be in a lot better mental space. We're going to be able to live at a better place. We're not going to be self-sabotaging our life. And we're going to be in this position to really receive God's goodness is what's going to happen. Verse 3, for I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth. And this is where we talked about all last week. I won't get all into it. Go back after you listen to this message. Go back to listen to part 1. The truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. And that truth is found in Jesus. And we talked about the three things. I'll read them. The questions we put out, did Jesus ever withhold from anyone? Of course, no. Did Jesus ever punish anyone? Of course, no. Did Jesus ever reject anyone? Of course, no. And that puts you in this position of faith of knowing God is infinitely for you, unconditionally pouring out blessings, never withholding. And that is the starting place of our connection with Thrive. So what are we switching over gears now? Okay, back to my other notes here. Let's talk about one of the major blockers here. And I want to deal with this one, particularly why am I going to talk about depression tonight? And I'm going to talk about it in three layers. I'm going to address briefly the physical side of it, because there is a physical, because we're three-part being. You got to address your physical side, your mental side of it, and the spiritual aspect. My primary focus, especially as a pastor, is to focus on the spiritual, to give you some mental tools and point you in some directions of what you can do. And the physical, I'm going to give some advice here to point you to particular people, because I'm not a licensed medical doctor by any moment. But I'll point you to some other thing because I'm not a licensed therapist. I am a pastor. I am schooled and educated in that. So there's certain parts I'll talk about. But not everything's in one person, by the way. So I don't feel threatened or insecure to point you to, hey, you know, I'm going to give you a part of it, but you may need to go here if you have additional things going on in your life. So that's where sometimes I think preachers, like people in the congregation, come up, why didn't this all work? I did what you said. Well, there may be other things going on in your life where you need additional things that collaborate with the starting place of the spiritual side, is what that is. So we want to, as ministers, we should not be ashamed of having to say that. So let's talk about depression, though. What is a blocker? So what is depression? It's feelings of severe despondency and dejection. Now, of course, immediately I was like, despondency and dejection. I was like, what does that mean? Go look it up. I did the work, so let me read it for you. Despondency means a state of low spirits caused by loss of hope or courage. It's a state of low spirit caused by loss of hope or courage. That's important to realize that we've gone through such a longevity of a pandemic. And I'll point out where that triggers depression. I'll do some statements. You'll be like, oh, that makes sense. But part of expectation, depression kicks out all your positive expectation because you're losing hope. So you're losing the expectation that things will get better. You're also losing the courage to do the things it takes to change because you feel like no matter what I do, things will never get better. And that's what depression tries to tell you in a nutshell, by the way. So told you the next part, dejection. What's dejection? Sad and depressed. Dispirited, or dispirit is what it is. Simple as that is what it means. What causes depression in a simplest form? I know there's a lot more to it. A doctor will get up and tell you all these other things. I'll give you some points, you some resources here for that. But in the simplest form for tonight's timing of message, by the way, it's long-term or ongoing difficulties. That is the cause that onsets depression. It's a long-term, ongoing set of difficulties, like a pandemic for over 2 years. That will cause it. And people can jump and say a lot of different things. There is many other things that will cause that. I'll give you some of my other areas, even maybe some personal areas I may share tonight. But it's the long ongoing. You see, when I was reading more up on it, a moment of something happening, a moment of sadness, a moment of going through something doesn't typically trigger depression. Depression is onset many times when there's this day-to-day grind, never really lifting negative circumstance on you. And what it starts telling you, the passage of time living under that negative circumstance, is it tells you things are never going to get better, that nothing you do matters, that things will never change, that this is the way the rest of life should be. That's what depression starts, grinding that mentality, and you have to break out of it. You have to snap out of it, because many a times it's not reality. The reality is you can do things that will change. Or you have to sometimes accept that maybe one area you can't, like there's the loss of a loved one. You cannot do anything to change that, but what you can do is accept that it happened and then say, well, that's not has to be the rest of my life in every other area, though. That this is not going to be the sole source of my joy and my hope in life is what that is. That there's other areas that can bring joy in my life. There's other areas that is worth living for. That there's other areas that can make me happy is what that is. Depression will choke out your ability to thrive in life, because it demotivates you also to do anything in life. And anything I'm saying, if it comes across a little straight or cold, I apologize in advance. It isn't meant to be. I want to be kind of nurturing with this message, encouraging and uplifting, and present you hope. Because I know you may feel like quitting. I know you may feel like it doesn't matter. I know you feel like it may can never change. That doesn't have to be life, though. Don't give up and don't quit. So let me address the physical side real quick. There's elements that I cannot address tonight that may be depression is also, I do have to acknowledge from a scientific point, there is some people that have physical elements that are causing the depression that you may need to seek medical treatment for. Don't be ashamed if you have to be on temporary short-term prescriptions or something that a doctor medically subscribes. Some people have mental chemical imbalances they were born with, a deficiency that they cannot do anything about. That sometimes you may have to take a medication to help balance that so why you can live and thrive. So when I say this, just get God and be spiritual and get the word and this and that. You need that, because without that, you will not get out from depression. I don't believe that. At the same time, though, that alone sometimes, if you do have a physical impairment that is going on in your life, and people do, it's more common than you think. Just a lot of people don't talk about it. There's a lot of shame around it. There's a lot of stigma around it, especially in church, because it's like you got weak faith, which has nothing to do with any of that. It's just simply, hey, you can take that medicine, still be in faith, still trusting God, still believe in God for a healing. But if you need that for that season, if you need that for part of your life, you need that for your day-to-day lifestyle to function and to be the healthiest version of yourself, don't be ashamed if that's what you need. There is people that, you know, get abuse it, get hooked on it. I get all that too. You got to be wise about who you select. Get a good doctor that knows how to prescribe those things, a therapist, psychiatrist, whatever area you need. That is okay. So I want to make sure I touch the physical side of this thing before I get to the other part. So that's all I'm going to say there, because I'm not a doctor. I just pointed you to one. But don't feel like this message in any way is to discredit any of that or to remove that if you need that. Now, let's talk about the practical steps everybody can do. Are you saying this is an all-inclusive practical list? Absolutely not. I am not saying that in any shape, form, or fashion. This is where I believe, and some of this I've gotten because I've talked to therapists, I've learned some things here or there, actual licensed therapists, by the way, and picked up some of these tools, by the way. And that's what a therapist should do. A therapist should empower you with mental tools and patterns throughout the day. And I'm not saying this is exactly what a therapist does. I'm not a therapist. But should empower you not to be hooked on them as a therapist, but to empower you to eventually wean off, actually, and be able to create your own mental habits and patterns to know when, oh, I recognize I'm triggered right now. I recognize, oh, I have a tendency to slide into depression. What can I do to make different patterns throughout my day, natural, practical patterns, to help me live a healthier lifestyle? So let me cover some of those real quick. You're like, man, this is very just like dead on informational kind of deal, more than just trying to do scripture after scripture after scripture. Sometimes you need that. Okay, so there is some practical side we got to do this. I am very big about application. So one, these are things that are going to be, these are practical things you can do to build up your hope, to build up positive expectation. These are daily things you got to do. A lot of the times people don't realize what I'm about to get into, they got to be not quantity always, but consistency. That's the word I'm looking for. It's the repetitiveness of doing this. Because when you repeat it, you create different mental habits. You create different patterns is what you do, is what it is. And you create different routines, which ultimately create a different total mindset. And you keep building and maintaining a healthy mindset is what it is. You have to, when you get in these mental places, especially depression things, you have to actively resist it at times. You have to actively do things to push it off. Also, because just whether you struggle with a medically diagnosed form of depression, just and overall, even if you don't have that going on, you're just your everyday Joe kind of deal is you still have to fight off hopelessness. More than ever right now, there's people struggling all in our city right now to pay rent, to put food on the table, to make ends meet. There's crime going up because of that. And the reason crime's going up is there's this constant thing, well, people are inherently violent. That's not true. People are being pushed to the breaking point. So at the same time, while I believe we need to make sure, you know, in one area, we make sure we kind of patrol and police things to a point, the real root of that problem is not overbearing, overdrawing, you know, let's crack down on crime. It's, hey, are you providing enough resources to get people out of that fear survival mode? And that will actually undercut a lot of that. Anyways, enough of my political adventure. Some people will be like, that's an opinion, pastor. Either way, let's get into this though. One, people you surround yourself with. The first point is, who are you surrounding yourself with? Are you surrounded with people that build you up or tear you down? If you're surrounded by constant, continuous complaining and negative talk and never talking about positive, are you saying you can't have vent sessions? Are you can't saying you can't talk about problems? Are you not saying you can't? Yes, you can, but you know the people that were, it's always a whirlwind of negativity. And you have to constantly remind yourself, let me be the positive. Let me bring the conversation or land, even if it is a negative, you come around and you say, but you know what? It's all going to work out anyways. And you go on and you keep that around you, surrounded with people, because you need community. That's what I tell people. It's like, why should we come back to church? Because the disconnect from human beings and building a community is so vital to your spiritual development and how you thrive, by the way. It's not just saying come back to church to support us. You could probably kind of halfway do that online, to be honest. But for your spiritual growth and development, it's important to engage with people. That will actually induce depression, by the way, if you don't engage with people. There's even studies that show if babies don't get touched enough in their newborn, and I mean like held, you know, burp, just the basic, or just laying on the mom or dad's chest, you know, something like that, that baby actually can even physically die from it, from just separation, the anxiety. You have to constantly keep that, is what you have to do. People are built with that. There was some things, you know, I was talking to a therapist about my son, you know, and he was doing remote learning because he had to during the pandemic. It was this constant push to try to get him still in the midst of the pandemic, somehow socially engaging the safest he possibly could. And then as time, things open back up, to get him more going, hey, get back to going to a birthday party, get back to doing this, engage with people. Because there was the concern about his social development and his emotional development and his full actual brain development isn't part of that. So this is so vital, who you surround yourself with. Surround yourself with people, though, that you feel encouraged with, that you feel blessed with, that you feel, man, and it doesn't have to always be, well, they better be a Christian that believes exactly the way that I believe. Listen, I've hung out with other people that just have a positive outlook on life. Not the crazy motivational speaker, but just friends that are good friends that listen, that build you up around you. You know, some people, they get into, I've seen people get into, there was the big CrossFit thing that went on, and some people are still in that. I've seen people, like, get into a yoga community, for example. And all they do, they bond over in positive of just working out together and having fun. It could be something like that, or play sports, you know, a rec league or something like that, and have fun with a basketball or football team, you know, things like that. It's whatever it is to build community camaraderie in a positive environment. That's going to be super important to combating that. Number two, you got to check the information you're exposed to. What are you exposing yourself to? And there's the part where I get, we have to be informed. We have to know what's going on. But after I'm informed and know what's going on, I don't have to watch all the details. I don't have to keep up with every play-by-play is what I have to do. I don't have to keep up with the political showboat drama is what it is by these bunch of, you know, reality TV show politicians. Because that's what it's all turned into for the most part when you watch the TV. So you don't have to keep up with every little detail. Well, they did this. Well, they did that. What I need to do is I need to be well-informed to make a quality decision. Let's say politics, for example. What do I need to be well-informed with? Not every play-by-play. I need to know what's going on so I can be a part of decision-making, so I can be part of making educated voting, so I know who to properly endorse that is going to actually better the overall humanity that is not defined by one party, by the way. All those different things. So that's what I'm talking about informed. I need to be informed or something I'm cautious about, you know. Talk about the tragic things that go on with racism, for example. And I know that can drastically affect the congregation I'm ministering to. But there's a point in place where it's like we're informed. Don't sit there and watch those videos every time. If that's your boundaries and that's going to take you to a place of destruction in your mind, don't watch somebody literally being shot over and over again. You know, something I'm cautious about. I'll read the article. I'll stay informed in the why because I want to be actively engaged in the part of, okay, well, we need to deal with these things. We need to make sure these things in our nation continuously to diminish, not increase, and we move forward with the progress. But I don't need to sit literally watch like I'm watching a play-by-play sports moment of someone literally being murdered. I mentally cannot handle all that part. That's going to cause me to be depressed because if you're constantly consumed with that, part of the thing with the news is, unfortunately, at the same time while it's informing you like we need, it's also telling you the world is burning down every day, everywhere, 24/7, and it makes you feel like that's everywhere you go, every restaurant you go, you're looking over your shoulder, and it creates almost a boogeyman complex or the devil behind every bush complex in the spiritual circles. And you don't want to be living in that place of paranoia. We'll get into more of that next week, though. That's stress and anxiety. But you got to watch what information you're being exposed to. And here's the thing. Information, when I say information, everybody's going to be triggered about which side. Listen, you also need to make sure the information you're getting exposed to is not one-dimensional. Many things, we know this about social media algorithms and everything else, they present you with what you continuously watch. So eventually over time, what happens, you're only exposed to a limited area of information. And sometimes you need to get exposed to even controversial point of views to make sure you keep a broad spectrum. Because what it'll surround you with is just everything that agrees with you. Well, that can reinforce depressing things, by the way. If you keep watching, here's what happens when every time you go on social media and you actually watch one of those murder videos, for example. Because it knows you liked it, the system does not have a way with that algorithm to say, well, this is an 18-year-old kid that don't need to keep watching this. Maybe we shouldn't keep putting that up. No, the algorithm's going to say, well, you liked that, you watched that, you shared that, let me put more of it for you. So then you wonder why you open up your social media and that information is going to keep repeating over. Now all you're seeing is the same destruction and chaos, yet there's good things happening at the same time. And that's not to diminish their suffering. Simultaneously, there is suffering going on 24/7 and there's goodness going on 24/7. And I'm never disconnected from the suffering. I just know, especially as a pastor that I had to learn in the pandemic, I got lost staring over into what I give the analogy, the pool of suffering. And I kept looking at it too long, kept being engaged in it too long, and didn't separate it for a moment to say, well, no, this part of my life is still good. That all of a sudden, all that I thought the world was and my life was suffering. And everything I'm talking about, I had to start saying, okay, for my head to stay in the game as a pastor to help people that are hurting, to be involved in people's lives, and to help, I've got to create some boundaries where I can. And that's going to look different for everybody because you're like, well, you don't know what I'm going through. I don't. I may not be exposed or experience all the things you have to experience on a day-to-day basis. I can admit that. But there's a time when I can lock my door in my home and say, let me do that, or put down the phone for a moment, or maybe say, let me not expose myself to this person, or to take that serenity moment and pause maybe 15 minutes in the middle of the day when I'm feeling overwhelmed and allow myself to be encouraged. Expose yourself to positive things, though. So we got to check that. Where are you pulling this from, Pastor? What's Proverbs 4:20? I haven't had time to read it, but 4:20, it talks about, you know, my son, pay attention to my words. Listen closely. Listen carefully. Do not let them out of your sight, for they are life to those who find them and health and healing to all their flesh. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Stay away from perverse and corrupt speech. Let's paraphrase all four verses right there. Verse 3, here's another thing to help you out. Dream. I didn't say fantasize only. I said dream about your future. Dream about your future. I have to constantly remind myself, dream about my future. It's okay to maybe dream about having a nicer car, a nicer place to live, a nicer this. And I don't mean getting into this place of the love of money or not being or being discontent. I mean, dream about growth. We're talking about expect to thrive. Well, dreaming puts a different image that the possibility something better could happen in my life. The possibility I could have a better job. The possibility I could make more money. And we all are going through our different levels of suffering and fighting through that. Don't get me wrong. But occasionally take time to dream. See the world in a better place. It's not in a better place. That's why it's a dream at times. And I didn't say fantasy. There's a difference. Dream, though, that things could possibly get better. Because the truth is, with God, they can. And with God, they do. Maybe not on an international level. Maybe not even on a national level. Maybe it's just on a personal level that you experience that. But whatever it is, remember to dream. Take time to dream about things going well. And sometimes it's just, I'm going to go to bed tonight, but I'm going to dream about, before I go to bed, tomorrow being a successful day. Tomorrow being a smooth day, even though I got all kind of stuff coming at me. Sometimes it may just be as simple as that. Your dream doesn't have to be so wild and out of there. It may just be, man, I'm dreaming about having peace between my spouse. Put a different image, because that's where hope comes in, is what that is. Number 4, do productive actions. What do you mean by that? Do productive actions. Do things that cause progress in your life. Sometimes it starts with the little things. Many times if you're experiencing this, sometimes it's dealt with little things. Like sometimes they tell you, get up and make your bed. I'm not big about making my bed. I will be honest. God, there's some things I hate making my bed. There's certain things, but that's a little controllable thing you can do that makes you feel better. So something I'll do, I don't really make the bed. I'll clean the kitchen. I'll do the dishes. I'll take out the trash. I'll wipe all the counters off, clean the fridge, you know, microwave, all that little detailed stuff, or clean the bathroom or vacuum, or go out and wash the car, make the car look better. You know, something simple you can do. You know, maybe I'm working on a project and I want to focus on finishing this project at work and I knock it out and get it, just hurry up and get it knocked out. Making progress though, positive progress, doing the little things is what it is. Or maybe, you know, man, I don't ever feel I can lose weight or this and that. Well, maybe it's just, hey, I went through a walk in the neighborhood today. And you only got it one day that week, but you made that effort. That's going to shift you. Because now you're doing something that you're seeing results in. And so that helps you realize, and it's just kind of pries the door open just a little bit to say, maybe life isn't as bad as I thought. Or maybe something is in my control. Maybe I can do something to improve my life and make it better, make me happier and thrive. Sometimes it just starts doing the little things. It doesn't have to be, I got to change the whole world and the nation and carry that on my shoulders and be this great influential leader. Sometimes it just starts with, man, in your home. These are practical, natural steps, though, that we can practice daily, by the way. The other things, number 5, I got 6 in total. So number 5 is help someone else in need. Boy, you want to talk about, here's something powerful. When you help someone in need, you find purpose again. And purpose will drive you. Purpose, you know, some people pass away early in life when they retire and things like that because they kick back and they just don't do anything. And then they start getting to this place, well, why am I here? Do I have any purpose? Nobody really needs me. Nobody really wants me. And sometimes it's just like, man, get busy helping someone or be engaged in your grandkids' life, it may be. Or, you know, maybe you see somebody on the street corner, give them that needs, go buy them lunch, you know, because they're hungry and doing that little thing. And it may be, you know, a little, you know, New York, you may, it's a little more expensive, you know, maybe a 10 little $15 meal for McDonald's or something like that. New York City prices, by the way. But anyways, it's just doing those little things, helping someone, or someone's cold, man, and you got an extra big coat jacket for the winter, you know, give them that big coat jacket is what that is. And just be a blessing or help someone else thrive in their career. Help someone be blessed and maybe go out of your way to do something and it can just be little. I'm not trying to give all the big extravagant things. I want to make it simple for anyone and everyone that's hearing me that can do something. And sometimes it may be as simple. I don't have any financial things. Sometimes just being kind to people. Open the door for them. Hold that extra second while everybody's fussing in the back at you, by the way, on the subway station, just so that person can catch the subway and not miss it and be late for work. Sometimes it's just those little things you can do, and it'll alleviate depression because while you're finding purpose again, you're like, oh, wow, I am valuable. I am needed. I am wanted. I do have something that matters, and I can do something that does cause positive change in my life. And it may not be the area that you really want it to be in yet at first. Because you're going to come to a place where you find some areas you just got to give over to God because they're bigger than you. So the areas that are bigger than you, give it to God and expect God to change it. And that's where it brings me to, I'm about to get into my final part, but let me give you 6, practice gratitude. Practice gratitude. How do I practice gratitude? You sit down for a moment when you're feeling depressed. Break out a pen and pad and start writing things down that have happened in your life. Not negative things. Do not write a negative thing. The good things. Hey, I remember I had this awesome lunch with this person a month ago. And it was really good and it really blessed my life. Thank you, God. Write it down, what happened, and then write on that next column, thank you, God. Because it's acknowledging God blessed you with that. You know what? Last month, I was able to pay all my bills on time. This month they're behind, but last month they were able to. Or let's start. Last year, I was able to I didn't have to sweat food last year. Oh, okay, let me write that down. Thank you, God. Oh, I remember, you know, 10 years ago, I had my first child. And man, I remember the blessing. I remember going through those things. Write that down. Thank you, God. And the list goes on, the list goes on, the list goes on. Oh, I remember, God, man, I got to do this 2-day vacation last year. And, you know, I was able to pay for it. Thank you, God. Because you're going to start realizing there's somebody else that's always got it worse than you, by the way, or going through something in that moment worse than you. But it allows you to rehearse all the good moments, and you see the evidence of God's goodness in your life. And you keep going back and back, because some of it may be, man, I went through this horrible thing, but you know what? I'm still here today. It didn't kill me. It didn't destroy me like I thought it would. Thank you, God. Whatever it may be, maybe I start with, thank you, God, I'm able to breathe okay today. Whatever it may be, thank you, God, is what it is. And you practice and you do the repetition of that, by the way. These are the practical things. Now, I'm going to go to one last thing. The spiritual aspect. You're like, man, this sounds really simple. Last week, we really hammered a lot of the spiritual aspect of trusting God and depending on God and thriving in God. So I didn't want to focus as much on that. But that's always still going to be an intricate part in all these things, because really, ultimately, I still believe a part of just overcoming depression, I think there is a spiritual thing. You have to be able to trust in a power that is greater than you. Because why am I going to have hope when I see all these things that are more powerful than me and my strength and my ability? Well, if I'm comparing to me, I'm going to be defeated and depressed. But if I compare them to God and trusting God's bigness and God's goodness and that God will see me, maybe not always over them, maybe it's through them. Maybe it's around them. I don't know whichever way it is, but I can trust God. So let me go to 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6, and I'm going to close with a scripture. Let me get over there. Bible's sticking together. It's getting a little old. That means it's a good one. 1 Timothy 6 and verse 17. Now, this is going to sound like a really different direction, but I want to catch one highlight here. Verse 17 says, teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money. That's important, because if you trust in temporal things and you put your hope and happiness in temporal things, when those things get kicked out, because money comes and money goes, things, material wealth comes and goes all the time. It's always revolving. It's always moving. Your hope can be the same way, and you'll be on the yo-yo roller coaster with it. So let me start at the top and read again. Teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable. Their trust should be in God, who is consistent, who is never changing, who is strong and mighty, who is unfailable, unfallible, by the way, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. See, God wants to be the source of your enjoyment, and God knows how to do it better than anybody. And when our expectation to thrive and experience goodness in this world is expecting God to do it, it's a game changer. Because we know God is infinitely stronger than anything we could be facing. Infinitely more powerful than anything we could be facing. That God is more infinitely wise when we don't have the answers God does. That when we don't find it, and really we should start with God, but when we don't find it in ourselves, that's when we know God has it. Because God never leaves us hanging. David, once again, I've never seen the righteous begging for bread. Why? Because God always takes care of. God is the infinite provider. God is the provider of our hope, by the way. And God, if you'll listen, take those moments and pause, like while you're writing those things of thanksgiving, the Spirit of God's going to be ministering to you also. In all these things, this relationship, the Spirit of God is going to be gently reminding you, hey, do you remember when this happened? Hey, do you remember when this? The Spirit of God is going to continue to be encouraging and cheering you on in positive things, saying, you got this. You can make it. Don't quit. Don't give up. Keep pushing. You're almost there. You'll be on the other side. Just a cheerleader and a champion. Hey, you're not going to fail. Hey, here's what you need to do. Here's the wisdom how to get this. Here's the wisdom how to fix this. Here's the wisdom how to navigate that. Why? Because God is our hope and source. And see, when we're constantly also getting answers provided to us, man, there's hope in that, because now we don't feel like, oh man, I'm defeated. I don't know what to do. Nothing I do matters. It doesn't matter. And that depression sets in. But man, no, God is constantly telling us we'll thrive and reminding us when we put our trust, because depression will thrive in a fear mindset, but when you're trusting God, there's hope, there's expectation, there's a dependence that things will get better. And actually, it'll open your eyes when we talked about setting the inside world right. Things are not as bad as they seem. I'm not saying they're not bad. I'm not saying I don't see, open my phone and see something that is just, I can't believe humans were capable of that kind of moments. But I also see on the flip side, I'll open the phone up and I'll see something different and I'll say, I can't believe humans were capable of such goodness too at the same time. It's what we fixate on. It's what we focus. How do we overcome evil? The Word of God's real clear. We overcome it with good. And so we fill up on goodness and pour that goodness out. And if everybody doing their part, folks, that will cause radical change for the better. So I want to wrap up tonight. If you have never made Jesus Lord of your life, you're tired of running the show, you're tired of feeling the way you feel, you're tired of feeling like there's no answers, you can't get out, well, it's receiving God in your life and saying, God, you know better, because clearly I've tried it on my own and I don't know how to do it. And I don't want you coming to God out of fear of hell, fear of all those different things. I want you to connect with God because you realize, God, I need this goodness in my life. I need the light of your love in my life because it will change me radically. And I want it to change me to reflect the same thing that's you're pouring into me, which is goodness. So if you have never made Jesus Lord of your life, repeat this prayer after me. Jesus, I invite you in my life. I pray that you open my eyes to your love, your goodness, your forgiveness, and your infinite grace. Change my world on the inside and change it on the outside. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, I'd first like to say congratulations. We celebrate the decision you made. Your life will be radically changed. It won't always be perfect. I'm not going to promise perfection, but man, you got something different on the inside of you. You got the hope giver on the inside of you that constantly shows you how to navigate and overcome every situation. For those in our YouTube page or Facebook page, put in the chat, congratulations. Make them feel welcome. Make them feel loved and appreciated. If you prayed that prayer, though, for the first time, here's what I'd like you to do. Text the keyword, I'm saved. That's I'm saved to 51555. I'm saved to 51555. We'll exchange some information with you, give you a chance to download a free ebook if you'd like to. I encourage you to read it, understand a little more about what you prayed, but we celebrate you and we say congratulations. Keep connecting. Keep coming back, man. I hope to see you in person on our Sunday services. If you stop by, just grab me, let me know. I would love a personal chance to meet you and greet you. If not, you're not able to, keep connecting with it on the stream. We love to have you here. And give us a shout out in the comments because we want to acknowledge you. Last thing I want to do before we wrap up, I want to give the opportunity to give. If you'd like to give and sow, if you believe in what this church is doing, man, you are a part of something so amazing. We have seen this congregation pull together in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of everything, in the midst of when churches were closing down and ministries going out, and we have been thriving. Not everything's been perfect. We've had our challenges. We've had our financial challenges up and down, but we have been thriving, and we have been even growing in our ability to minister to people. You know, so that's what we're doing apart. It's not about appeasing God. It's not about a fear-based give. It's not about trying to get. It's an overflow of what God has already done in our lives. And if you're stressed out, it's like, man, I can't give this. I'm not asking to give the rent. Please don't do that. Pay your rent, okay? Give with what you have peace with and what you're able to, and what God is just simply writing on your heart. And know that is more than enough. Some people are like, man, they throw a dollar in. It doesn't matter. It's the heart that matters, actually, at the end of the day. That's what is most important. And what happens on the natural side, that goes back into operations here, taking care of everything, and we sow it right back into members that have needs, and we sow it right back in our community through outreach, getting this message of hope out, doing monetary things we're able to do, But that's all because of you. We're able to show God's goodness in people's life because of people just like you, a part of this church. So we thank you for it. The information is on the lower thirds. Text the Gives Up on the 917 number. Text WCNYC to do that. We have our little QR code up. You can hold up your camera phone. It'll pop up a little yellow link when you scan that. Click on that, and you'll be able to give that way. We got our mobile app. You can do that. And, of course, we got our P.O. box. Just follow the information with the address and how to make out the money orders and checks, and we'll receive it that way. But we thank you in advance. So we'll pray over that, and then we'll move to the next part of service. So, Heavenly Father, we come before you. We submit these gifts to you of honor, of gratefulness, and we thank you for the wisdom that is imparted to us for these funds to be a blessing to people's life, to go where you want them to be strategic, to maximize them, to take care of every need. We continue to thrive, and now we're causing other people to thrive, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. All right, everybody, I got a few quick announcements, then we'll be right back here, and I'll dismiss us. Welcome back, everybody. Let's pray and we'll dismiss. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you for tonight's word. We thank you for the seed that is sown into us, that it continues to grow and thrive, and it will not be choked out by any fears, cares, or worries of this life. That your hand is upon us, that we know your presence is evident more than ever, that your hand of protection is on us, your hand of healing, your hand of life. You are causing us to thrive in every way possible, and we live in a place of gratitude. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, everybody. Have a great night. I'm a world changer.